Hello, kiddies. Be sure to subscribe.
And click that bell.
Yes, Freddy, we know. Click the bell. That way you'll always be up to date on all the latest slasher mayhem brewing in the 80s slasher library.
And click that thumbs up. Because if you don't, I'll make sure you never have pleasant dreams again.
And be sure to follow the 80s slasher librarian on Twitter. Join the Facebook group page and the subreddit. Links in the description below. Join now, or playtime will be over. Tonight's upload is brought to you by the patrons of the 80s Slasher Librarian. That's AlleyWay and DK.
Bonanza Jellybean, Daniel Mackey, Bree Girl,
Dave Arnold, Alex Vanover, Carl Eakins, Cecilia Spears, Krista Campbell, Allison Saib, Hawaii, Iron Elixir, Jay Gardner, Catherine McClear, Kristen Kay, Lauren Vaught, Liam Anderson,
Michael, Rob Davey, Ryan Woodward,
Sean Campbell, William Schaefer, and Willow Ravenwood. Thank you, kiddies, for supporting the channel on Patreon.
We couldn't do it
without you. And anyone listening right now, if you would like to support this channel and see it keep going and growing for years to come, then check out the links in the description below for the Patreon page and the merch store.
You are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Friday the 13th, the novelization by Simon Hawke. Chapter 9. Alice came to an abrupt halt less than a yard from the tall, slim, blonde woman who stood before her, dressed in boots, slacks, and a sweater.
Who are you?
She whimpered, backing away. The woman gave her a friendly smile.
Why, I'm Mrs. Voorhees, an old friend of the Christies.
Alice ran up and threw her arms around her, sobbing.
Help me, please.
Now, dear. I can't help you if you don't calm down, please.
Said Mrs. Voorhees, trying to comfort her.
But she... He's... dead and... Oh my God! Poor Bill! Oh God, they're dead!
Sobbed Alice, gasping for breath.
All right.
Said Mrs. Voorhees, as if trying to humor her.
All right. Come on, dear, then show me.
No!
Alice screamed, moving away from her.
No!
But it's all right.
Mrs. Voorhees shook her head and smiled.
I'll take care of you. I used to work for the Christies.
Oh, God!
Alice sobbed.
Please, you've got to help me get out of here.
It's just this place.
Said Mrs. Voorhees.
No!
Said Alice, shaking her head. The woman clearly didn't believe her. She had to make her believe.
And the storm. That's why you're upset.
No!
Said Alice, shaking her head violently.
No! No, they're all dead.
All right. I'll go look.
Said Mrs. Voorhees, nodding.
No, please. Don't leave me.
Alice grabbed her arm. Mrs. Voorhees laughed.
I'm not afraid.
She disengaged herself from Alice's grip and started walking purposefully toward the cabin. Feeling helpless, Alice hurried after her, unwilling to go back yet, terrified of being left alone. The minute they were back inside the cabin, Alice pulled the door shut behind them, looking around fearfully. Mrs. Voorhees gasped at the sight of Brenda's body on the kitchen floor.
Oh, my Lord.
She looked down at Brenda, then glanced up at Alice, but she didn't seem to be seeing her.
So young. So pretty. Oh, what monster could have done this?
Bill's out there!
Alice said. She wanted to tell her that Bill had been killed too, and probably Jack and Marcy and Ned, but she couldn't go on. She'll see now, she told herself. She'll realize the terrible danger that we're in, and she'll help me get away from here. But Mrs. Voorhees showed no sign of leaving.
Oh, God. It's this place. She never should have opened this place again. There's been too much trouble here. Did you know that a young boy drowned the year before those two others were killed?
Her voice suddenly took on a hard edge.
The counselors, they weren't paying any attention.
Alice stared at her.
They were making love while that young boy drowned.
Mrs. Voorhees said, making love as though it were an obscenity. Her eyes glazed.
His name was Jason.
Alice didn't understand. What was she talking about? What was wrong with her? They had to get out of here, but the words wouldn't come. It was as if a fist had suddenly closed around her heart and started squeezing.
I was working the day it happened, preparing meals.
Mrs. Voorhees said, coming towards Alice, her eyes vacant as if she were in a trance.
I was the cook.
Without warning, she grabbed Alice, her fingers like talons closing around her arms in an incredibly powerful grip. As Alice gasped, Mrs. Voorhees shook her hard enough to make her teeth rattle.
Jason should have been watched. Every minute, he was...
Her voice trailed off and suddenly focused on Alice, seeing her clearly for the first time. Her face relaxed and she smiled a chilling smile. Only the mouth moved. The eyes remained fixed on Alice in a baleful glare.
He wasn't a very good swimmer,
she said. Then she laughed, crazy laughter.
We can go now, dear.
Oh, God, thought Alice, realization slowly dawning.
I think we should wait for Mr. Christie.
She struggled to keep her voice steady. Mrs. Voorhees cackled again.
Oh, that's not necessary.
I don't understand,
said Alice, slowly backing away from her.
Jason was my son, and today is his birthday,
said Mrs. Voorhees, her eyes getting that mad, faraway look again.
Where is Mr. Christie?
Alice asked, but Mrs. Voorhees acted as if she hadn't heard. Her eyes were unfocused, looking inward somewhere, seeing twisted visions from the past. Visions of a young boy floundering weakly in the lake, arms thrashing, sputtering as water filled his mouth, crying.
Help! Help, Mommy! Help!
A small boy drowning, crying for help. A boy who had never cried before. A boy who had always been disturbingly silent, never speaking, never laughing. A boy who lived in his own strange, silent world. Shunned by other children, always keeping to himself.
Oh, I couldn't let them open this place again, could I?
Said Mrs. Voorhees.
Not after what happened.
She shook her head as if to dispel the vision of her son sinking beneath the surface of the water. But the vision would not go away. It played in her mind constantly, over and over and over. She dreamed about it. It plagued her while she was awake. The guilt had gnawed at her sanity, relentlessly nibbling it away until finally Pamela Voorhees had gone completely, totally mad.
Oh, my sweet, innocent Jason,
she said, tears welling up in her eyes.
My only child, Jason.
She turned to look at Alice, her gaze boring into her, her eyes wide, pupils dilated, the corners of her mouth twitching.
You let him drown!
Alice felt hypnotized by the snake-like stare, like a rabbit mesmerized by a cobra. She wanted to scream, she wanted to run, but she couldn't move a muscle. Her mouth was dry, her skin felt clammy. She stood motionless and silent, but her mind was screaming.
You never paid any attention!
The mad woman shrieked. There was a table between them. Mrs. Voorhees suddenly grabbed it and flung it aside as if it didn't weigh a thing. The crash of the table snapped Alice out of her disbelieving shock, and her muscles finally responded. She jerked and shook her head, blinking away tears.
No! No!
Look what you did to him!
Cried Mrs. Voorhees, snarling as she raised her sweater, revealing the hunting knife in the sheath on her belt. Alice looked around in panic, forgetting where she had dropped the baseball bat, and her gaze lit on the fireplace, on the long, pointed iron poker. Mrs. Voorhees screamed like a wild animal and clawed the knife from its sheath, raising it high as she lunged at Alice. Alice grabbed for the poker and brought it down hard, swinging it with all of her might as Mrs. Voorhees leaped at her. The side of the poker connected with her head, and Alice felt the impact all the way up her arm. With a grunt, Mrs. Voorhees staggered and collapsed onto the couch. Alice brought the poker down again, clubbing her across the back, then stood over her, holding the weapon high, ready to bring it down again. The woman didn't move. My God, Alice thought. She's crazy. She's killed all the others and now I've killed her. Then she saw that the woman was still breathing, and a small voice in her mind, a hysterical instant voice, a voice that suddenly frightened her almost as much as Mrs. Voorhees, had said, "Finish it!" Alice backed away, shaking her head, not willing to listen to that voice. She sobbed and dropped the poker, then turned and fled out of the cabin, thinking, "The car! Get to the car! Get out! Run!" Behind her, Mrs. Voorhees stirred and moaned, slowly pushing herself up on the couch. Alice ran sobbing toward the Jeep. The headlights were still on. She prayed that Mrs. Voorhees had left the keys in the ignition. She reached the Jeep and yanked open the door. Annie's blood-spattered body was propped up in the passenger seat, throat slashed from ear to ear. Alice recoiled, screaming hysterically. Even if the keys were still in the ignition, there was no way she could have jumped inside that Jeep with Annie's body in there and blood all over the seats. It would have taken more than she had to get inside, push the body out and drive away. It would have taken reason and cold logic, and all that Alice felt now was a blind, unreasoning panic, a screaming hysteria that shouted at her to get away, to run. It didn't matter where, just run, escape, flee from the horrid reality. She bolted down the path, slipping in the mud, unable to stop screaming. Her feet slid out from under her and she slammed to the ground. The wind almost knocked out of her, but she scrambled up again, terrified, slipped again and ran, barely able to see anything in front of her. Suddenly, a shape loomed up out of the darkness before, and she skidded to a stop, almost running into Steve's body hanging upside down from a stout branch over the trail. It turned slowly in the wind, dripping blood onto the path like a slab of meat in a slaughterhouse. Pamela Voorhees heard the screams and grinned. She stood outside the cabin, oblivious to the cut on her head where Alice had struck her with the poker. She felt no pain, only a raging lust to annihilate the girl responsible for Jason's death. They were all responsible. All those spoiled, immoral young people, juvenile delinquents, who took jobs as camp counselors so they could drink beer and take drugs and fondle one another in the darkness, doing filthy, disgusting things to each other, coupling like animals, heedless of the tender, innocent young lives that had been entrusted to them. They all had to pay, just as those who hired them had to pay. They were all responsible for 20 years she had relentlessly pursued her crusade. Ever since that night, she had been working late in the kitchen, performing mindless tasks, washing pots and pans several times, scrubbing the sinks and counters obsessively until they gleamed. She was always intent on finding things to keep her busy, to occupy her mind so she wouldn't keep seeing the image of her son sinking in the lake, so that she wouldn't think of Jason thrashing weakly at the water as it filled his lungs. Steve's father had kept her on as the camp cook, feeling sorry for her, sympathizing with her loss even though he'd had his doubts about her coming back after her son had drowned, questioning the wisdom of her being where it had all happened, seeing the lake, hearing the laughter of other children. She had begged him, pleaded with him, and he had relented. She seemed to need it. It seemed to help her, being around the children. It seemed to mitigate her loss, and she was so good with them, so attentive and caring. Perhaps it was just the therapy she needed for overcoming her grief, but the first seeds of the madness had already taken root. Being around the children only made her miss Jason that much more. Seeing them playfully splashing in the lake only made her think of Jason thrashing pitifully as he vainly fought to stay afloat. It made her think of his tiny body down in the muck at the bottom of the lake, slowly rotting. No matter how hard she worked, trying to exhaust herself to the point where she could no longer even think, she could not rid herself of the pain that ate away at her, pain that slowly turned to raging hatred of those who were responsible for Jason's death. At night, she dreamed of him, and dreamed of his rotting body rising up from the lake. She heard his voice calling to her on the wind.
Help me! Mommy! Mommy, help me!
Someone trained in psychiatry might have spotted the telltale signs. The obsessive way she went about her tasks, performing them all with a single-minded, abnormal intensity. Someone who knew what to look for might have noticed her gradual withdrawal, the increasing periods of preoccupation, the manic overcompensating, forced cheerfulness around other people, the edge of hysteria in her laughter, the dark foreboding in her silences. But no one noticed, and madness had a crafty tendency to masquerade as sanity for fear of being discovered. She had heard them singing. She had stood inside the darkened cabin watching the children sleeping peacefully, tears running down their cheeks. She went through their cabins every night to look at them while they slept, to bless them, to pray for their safety, and it broke her heart to see them laying there so sweet and innocent, so quiet. Jason had always been so quiet, and she had heard them singing. She thought of Jason alone and filled with fear as he sank into the murky water, and as they sang, the words came drifting to her on the warm summer breeze. River Jordan is deep and wide, hallelujah. She couldn't stop the tears. The pain was more than she could bear. She stared down at the tiny sleeping forms, so quiet, so still. Milk and honey on the other side, hallelujah. Poor Jason, sleeping on the bottom of the lake alone. No one had heard him calling out for help. No one came in to answer his cries. No one had saved him. And she heard them singing. She had stood in the shadows watching them, watching the way they looked at one another, seeing the lust in their eyes, the way that boy and girl kept looking at each other while they sang. It was dirty, filthy. She saw them get up and walk off, hand in hand, heading toward the barn. Saw them pause at the door to kiss, to run their hands over one another's bodies. Jason was drowning and no one could hear. They couldn't hear because he was crying out for help, and she heard them singing. And she didn't remember going back into the kitchen. She didn't remember taking the carving knife out of the drawer. She had only the vaguest memories of entering the barn, the knife in her hand as she quietly climbed the stairs to the loft where they were lying on top of one another, moaning and groaning like animals. But she remembered their screams. Yes, screams, she had thought, as she had hacked away at them. Scream, no one will hear you, just as you never heard Jason. She heard them once again as Alice screamed in terror at the sight of Steve Christie's butchered body, and she smiled as she moved swiftly in the direction of the screams. The 8-inch hunting knife grasped firmly in her hand. Her lips moved as a small voice, a child's voice, issued from her throat.
Kill her, Mommy! Kill her!
She quickened her pace.
Don't let her get away, Mommy! Don't let her live!
I won't, Jason! I won't!
Thank you.
Okay, Slashaholics, you've just heard an early access upload from the Patreon page. On Patreon, you'll get early access to this book and others to be named in the future. All great slasher novels. All early access titles on Patreon will have weekly chapter uploads that premiere on Patreon 2 to 3 weeks before they make it to YouTube. So, if you want to have early access to Friday the 13th by Simon Hawke, head on over to Patreon. Thank you all so much for listening. Hope you're enjoying this book so far. And as always, pleasant dreams!